The feast of our parish, the Dormition of the Theotokou, that we celebrated so beautifully this past week on Monday evening, and on Tuesday morning with His Eminence Metropolitan Sabas here with us, gives us a chance to reflect on not only the Christian life, but on the life after death. And rather than speaking exclusively on the feast day of our parish, on the Kimisis, on the Dormition of the Theotokos, I wanted to tie this feast in somehow with the great feast of the Transfiguration that we celebrated on August 6th, the Transfiguration of Christ, or the Metamorphosis του Sotiros, as we call it in Greek. When Jesus had taken up his three disciples to Mount Tabor, he was transfigured before them. And he is seen in sparkling raiment, brighter even than the sun itself. And there we see him kind of within time, but also outside of time. And outside of time because we see in this image and in the icon of the Transfiguration two persons, two saints. There's Moses and there is Elijah. Moses represents the dead according to the tradition of the church. Why? Because Moses died a physical death, like most people, if not all people, do. But Elijah, we read, did not die, so far as we know, a physical death. He was rather assumed into heaven, brought to heaven away from his disciple Elisha. And after Elijah gives his mantle over to the prophet Elisha, he is brought up to heaven in what seems to be an entourage of chariots and horses, and he's carried up into heaven. So Elijah represents the living. And here we have Christ in between, the representative of the dead and the representative of the living, to show that he is within time and outside of time. He is Lord and Master of the living, and Lord and Master even over the dead. But what we see in Christ is the same appearance, if you will, as we see him after his resurrection. When Jesus came back from the dead, when Jesus was resurrected on the third day, the church has, I don't want to say debated, but has asked the question, what was this Christ like? Well, we know for one thing from the Gospels that when he returned not as a spirit, as some early heretics believed in the church, but he came back as flesh and blood, as he was when he was alive. But there was something very distinct about his appearance. He was alive as flesh and blood, but there was something unique about him. There was something transfigured about him. He did not feel pain or hunger or thirst anymore as he did when he was alive. But now we can say that he is alive in its fullest understanding of life, that he no longer belongs to this world, and yet he does belong to this world through the sacraments of the church. But here we see Christ as Lord and Master and victor over death, but he has become somewhat transfigured. It is only through the eyes of faith that people now can see him. Yet he is alive. There are no relics left behind of Christ. There are no bones. There's no articles of clothing except maybe the shroud that we have and the holy napkin, which we celebrate on August 16th, the day after Panagias. But we don't have any relics of his. But he is alive. And so what we see on Mount Tabor is the Lord transfigured as he was transfigured after his resurrection. How does this now tie in to the Dormition feast? We see the Theotokos, who also dies a physical death. This is, of course, the tradition, the predominant tradition, the only tradition in the East, that she died a physical death. But as we know from the Synaxaria, which I mentioned during the feast in my homily on in the evening, the Theotokos dies a physical death. And she is buried, as Christ was buried, into a tomb in the Garden of Gethsemane. And as the disciples were there to carry her to her final resting place, or so it seemed, her final resting place, 3 days later, when Thomas once again comes to them and wants to venerate her body, because he was not able to be there when she passed away and when she was buried, the disciples take him to Gethsemane. We should call them the apostles because it's after the resurrection. So they take him to Gethsemane, and when they go to the tomb is empty, just like the Christ. There is no one in there. There are no angels this time. The tomb is empty, and there is only the sash, the belt of the Theotokos, or an article of clothing that belonged to her. And then when they look up into the sky, they see her as they saw Christ. When he ascended into heaven, they see the Theotokos looking down at them and blessing them. And almost as if what Christ said to them, to the disciples and to his church when he ascended into heaven, I will be with you always to the end of the age. And so the Theotokos' message is the same. And I will be with you always to the end of the age. So the Theotokos experiences a transfiguration. She is raised bodily, the only mortal to be raised bodily after Christ. And in this resurrection of hers, she is likewise assumed into heaven, and she is alive and continues to pray for us. The Theotokos is likewise transfigured. She enters into the state of existence the way all of us will be, and the way all people from the very beginning of time will be after the second coming. This is a basic, fundamental doctrine of the Church, that we will experience this transfiguration like Christ did before his death and crucifixion, as the Theotokos did after her Kimisis, after her Dormition. So we will experience this as well. So here we have then this tie-in. The Theotokos is the mother of the Church. We often call the Church our mother. We call God our Father. So how is the Theotokos our mother? For one, she gives birth to hope. She gives birth to faith, and she gives birth to love. Those of you who are mothers, and those of us who are not mothers, but know the value of a mother, know that when we think of our mothers, we always think that they're there overlooking everything we do. Sometimes that overlooking can be kind of annoying, because they maybe overlook too much. But they're always there to make sure that we are safe, that we are fed, that we are protected, and that we have everything we need to be happy and live fulfilled lives. And a mother, we know, is someone who constantly gives, but does not demand anything back. She may expect her children to love her back, but she doesn't really even expect that. All she asks for is that her children are well. And so the Theotokos is our mother. She constantly gives, gives of her time, gives her love, gives an example for all of us to follow. And the most important thing that she gives to us is Christ. There is an icon of the Theotokos that you may have seen before. It is the Theotokos as the Ihumeni do I hear orders. The Theotokos is the abbess of Mount Athos. That's a kind of a unique icon. It is mounted in the story that says that the Theotokos was given when she was traveling from Ephesus with John, or on their way to Ephesus, with the disciple John, into whose hands our Lord gave Panagia so that she could watch over them, so that he could watch over her. The Theotokos was given this beautiful plot of land in northern Greece, the third peninsula in the northern Greece, what has become known as the Holy Mountain in Chalkidiki. And it was there that the Theotokos said, I would like to have this plot of land to call my own. And so the Lord gave this to her, and then in the 11th century, or the 10th century, when Mount Athos, when the first monastery was built on Mount Athos, the Theotokos, this story came back to the monks, and Mount Athos was established as the Perivoli της Panagias, the garden of the Theotokos, of the Panagia. This Perivoli, to this day, remains her. And so what we see in this icon is all the federation of 19 monasteries in the icon. And what we have is the Theotokos standing over Mount Athos, over the peninsula, wearing the royal mantias, which is normally the bishop wears, or the abbot of the monastery when he presides at services. And she is carrying the crozier, or the bravos, the staff, the pastoral staff. And it is here that she directs, as the abbess of this all-male monastery, she directs the decisions and the prayer life and the spiritual life of the monks on Mount Athos. The Theotokos here is shown giving to the monks Christ. The Theotokos in our church gives us Christ. And I've mentioned this before for the benefit of those of you who didn't hear me say this before, or probably say it, this is probably the 100th time I'll say it. Look at the icon behind me of the Blanditera. What is she giving? She's giving Christ with her hands outstretched like this. The hands are outstretched in the orange position to show that she is in prayer, but she is giving Christ also to us. And Christ, we see, holding the scroll of the will of God, his own will, and blessing with his right hand. And this is the role of the monk, is to give. But at the same time, her hands are outstretched. Because when we stretch out our hands, we not only give praise to God and ask, supplicate him, but we're also receiving. And so she asks only that we pay attention to the fruit of her womb, to the one that she gives to us with her hands outstretched like this. She is asking us not to praise her, although we do, out of piety and out of love for her, but it is to focus our attention on Christ, to focus our attention on Christ, to be obedient to his will, and to persevere in this life, to persevere in this life with the help of God. This is, in many ways, the kind of understanding of why the Theotokos is so important. You know, this is a very basic question we ask ourselves. Why are the saints so important? You know, and a lot of people will say, well, they're important because they pray for us. And I agree, but that's not the only reason they're important. The saints are important because they identify for us what we are called to be come. If you look at them, you notice the gold background. The gold background is the transfigured state. It's the state of glory that they have entered into. That gold background is the energy of God into which they have entered and participated. It's their holiness. They have attained that holiness. But remember that before they came on the walls of our churches, they were here in our midst. And we all know that they did not have a very comfortable life. 99.9% of the saints did not have a very comfortable life. They had a miserable life, a life filled with suffering. But what gave them that aura around them is their union with God and perseverance. They lived in the desert, but they did not become part of this desert. They lived in this chaotic world, but they did not become part of the chaotic world. They were rebels. When we hear of saints, we often think that they were kind of went with the status quo and simply prayed a lot. No, they were rebels. They rebelled against everything that this world stood for because they loved this world and they wanted this world to get back to its normal state of relationship with God. So these saints are in a transfigured state and they share this holiness with God himself. As the Theotokou did, as she was transfigured at her Dormition, as Christ himself is transfigured before his own death, Christ sets the model for us. This is where we are heading. So we are in the process of becoming saints, all of us. And a lot of you might say, of course, well, I could never become a saint. With attitudes like that, you won't be. But that's not the right attitude, because I'm going to throw something very... I'm going to be radical right now. I'm going to throw something very disturbing at you. So I'm going to apologize ahead of time. Our lives are meant to be assumed by sainthood. We live to become saints. How we become saints or when is up to God. But that has to be our absolute goal. To fall short of that does not mean that God hates us. But God expects of us to become saints. If we don't become saints, and this, I'll throw myself in the mix because I'm the worst sinner of all. If we don't become saints, we're only Christians in name. I know that sounds very harsh, but remember the words of Christ. Become perfect in the Gospel of Matthew. Become perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. This doesn't mean that we abandon everything that we do in life. It simply means we orient ourselves around Christ. Whatever we do in life, whatever we accomplish, whether we are housewives, or whether we are physicians, or attorneys, or have businesses, or have families, or live single, whatever we are, whatever we do, we must do it in the context of Christ. Whatever we do, I remember a professor of mine telling me in grad school, whatever you do, do it well. What he was trying to say is, whatever you do, keep focused on Christ. Because ultimately, it's not how much money we make, not how successful we are, it's how well we did the things that God gave us. And when he gave us, were we able to transform our lives and to transfigure the lives of others. This is our goal. To be called a doctor with a title in front of our name doesn't mean anything. But to have the title of saint in front of our name means everything. Because the one title is bestowed to us by God. The other titles in this life are bestowed to us by each other. Where is the value here? The value is up there. So this is the calling. It's not an easy calling. We often hear that Christianity is difficult. There's a cross we all have to carry. It's not an easy life. But that is what we are called to do. And so Christianity is about becoming like Panagia. It's like becoming like Saint Irini, like Saint Ephrem, becoming like Saint Demetrius and Saint George, and Saint Stelyios and Saint Maximus, and Saint Sophia des Pisuras. It's becoming like these saints. Each of us in our own way, and if you look at all the saints, the female saints, they weren't all housewives. For sure they weren't. They were rebels. The men, they weren't all bishops or priests. Most of them were soldiers. Many were emperors and princes. Whatever we are, wherever we come from, we must keep Christ focused. So, I know I'm rambling here, but to conclude, what are we called to be in this life? Saints. If we're Christians and we're striving to become saints, then we are on the narrow road that leads to salvation. If we're struggling and we don't attain sainthood, but stay on the road, that is just as fine. The sainthood is not for us to judge. God is the one who gives that to us. But we have to remain focused on Christ to enter into this transfigured state, into this transfigured world, to become part of this assembly of countless saints, billions, most of whom we don't even know their names, yet we know they died for the sake of Christ. So let us enter into their company, and let us remember always, as we remember these days, the Theotokos, and our church continues the celebration of the Dormition. Let us remember who she is, our mother, calling us to accept him, to become one with him, and to enter into the transfigured state that she herself has entered and remains and continues to intercede for us, so that we may do that for the rest of the world as well. It is not impossible to become a saint. It is possible. The impossibility lies with our will. How much do we want it? How serious are we about our Christian faith? How serious are we about what it means to be a Christian? These are the major questions. May God then bless us with a continued celebration of our feast, the Feast of the Dormition. May God bless us. May God bless you too. And may God keep us all well and healthy as we continue our celebration of our journey to the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Let us stand and conclude our meeting.